Start our Proverbs series in the summer series we're doing in the book of Proverbs called Vintage Wisdom. Hey, I want to say good morning, Fort Lupton campus. Come on, let them know you're here. Good morning, Fort Lupton campus. Woo! Yeah, see, we got it going on up here. And good morning, North Glen and Thornton and online Crossroads Church. Great to have you with us this morning. Beautiful summer Sunday morning. I'm really happy to be back. Went to Israel with 39 people, got back safe. It was a great trip. I try to lead a trip every odd summer. The Lord met us there. We stood there with our Bibles in one hand on the place that happened. It was amazing. I also went to Portland last week. That's why I've been away for our church denominational meetings in Portland. Really good and very happy the direction our denomination is going. Very encouraged by that. Hey, if you're watching online or you're at a remote campus, you'll see the football field behind me. That's because this next week at Fort Lupton campus, it's their turn now for Vacation Bible School, VBS, where dozens and dozens of kids, as they did at Thornton and North Glen campus, will come and they'll have a blast. Our volunteer base is amazing. Thank you if you're helping out with Vacation Bible School this week. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And kids will meet Jesus, so keep Fort Lupton campus in your prayers. Yesterday, big men's breakfast. That was great. Valley Bank brought their pancake cooker. That was awesome. The men showed up at Fort Lupton. Busy campus up here at Fort Lupton. Things are happening here. And you got flies all over the place. I got a fly coming at me right now. So we are in a summer series called Vintage Wisdom, where we're looking at the book of Proverbs. And part of wisdom as a church, you might know, is to do wisely with our finances. And we do. Cross, I'm so proud of this church. But I want to say something real quick. This is our new fiscal year. Budget year goes July 1 to June 30th. So we're in a new fiscal year. And I was just thinking about making sure that I said to you, thank you for your support of this church. You know, we don't sell stuff. We don't make widgets to sell. We proclaim and declare the gospel. And we do so in mission across the world in partnership under the vision of serving people toward and connecting them to Jesus. That's what Crossroads has done. For 55 years, I've been here 35 of those years. This is my 35th year. This August will be my... And every year, every week, I see us as we contribute to the work of the church together, all of us. It meets the needs. I just want to say thank you for your generous giving, your faithful giving to Crossroads Church. Truly, 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 it makes a difference. God sees it, and we honor him in our giving. So thanks for being a part of that. So if you have a Bible, turn to Proverbs chapter 35. We're going to go there in just a minute. A refreshing book of the Bible. Very, very practical, common sense book of the Bible, giving us wisdom for daily life. Almost every verse is kind of a nugget you can take. Some of you are doing our reading plan, reading through the 31 chapters in the book of Proverbs for the summer. Great way to just kind of get common sense into your head. Solomon wrote it. The words of Solomon, the first verse says, the words of Solomon, son of David, king of Israel. So we are going through topically the book this summer, as we do each summer, try to take a book of the Bible. But this time we're going through it topically because that's what Proverbs allows us to do, drawing out wisdom from Proverbs. And we've said every week, and we will say every week, and this is the first point, is wisdom is this is how Proverbs lands on wisdom. Wisdom is navigating life successfully and skillfully in our relationships. And this week, I'm talking about our responsibilities, what we're called on to do, something we probably all want, wisdom, navigating life skillfully and successfully. So we're taking general themes. So the first week, Pastor Matt did an overview. Pastor Matt, Pastor Tim, and myself are doing this series, which, by the way, if you remember, you think back to that sermon bumper with the Volkswagen bus, I realized that between Pastor Matt, who's 30-something, Pastor Chris, or Pastor Tim, who's 30-something, and me, who's double that, I'm the only one that's actually driven a Volkswagen bus. Actually, I owned one. So anybody else own a VW bus, like the Love Mobile? My goodness, John, you know what? That makes all kinds of sense knowing you. So I have a special affinity to the vintage piece of wisdom. So Pastor Matt talked about general life and then a general overview of wisdom. Then he talked about relationships, good work there, good word on how we make decisions. Last week, Pastor Tim aptly brought us through hot topic and one that has a lot of complexities to it in our world today, what Proverbs has to say about sexuality. And by the way, all this, all these sermons, as well as all the supporting material, is available free on our website always or through the Crossroads app. So this week, I'm going to talk about wisdom as we apply it to our work, what we do in our jobs. And then next week, how our words how wisdom is applied to our words. I'll talk about that. And then the final week, I'll wrap it up with just general living according to Proverbs. And then July 29 and 30, the last week of this month, is a celebration weekend, what we call a worship weekend, just full worship weekend. It's really a highlight at Crossroads Church. We try and do it 3 or 4 times a year. It's also baptism weekend. So some of you maybe have not yet been baptized as a statement of your faith in Jesus Christ. Well, we'd love to do that for you and have that as a something in your future immediately at the end of this month and be part of that celebration. And you want to do that? Get started here. crossroadsabc.com/baptism on July 29 and 30. All right, let's talk about work. Most of you know that my wife Cheryl and I have 6 kids, 3 boys, 3 girls, who ranging in age from 33, so I've actively been parenting for 33 years, 33 to 17. So it hasn't been a break, 33 years of active parenting. And they came into our home, 2 of them through biological activity. I refer you back to last week's sermon. And the other 4 through adoption and foster care. And I love all my kids. I die for any of my kids. And sometimes people think, because we have a lot of kids, that I know how to raise them. And so they will ask me, what's some advice you could give me? I don't know. I do like you do, just try to trust in the Lord. But I do have a philosophy of parenting. And my philosophy of parenting is simply this: raise your kids. This is how we raised our kids. We raised our kids to not need us, but to thoroughly and always need Jesus. That's how we raised them. And now as we're getting to the end of that, and Destiny, our youngest, is 17, we've added 1 word, and do it as quickly as possible. That's what we're doing now. But to raise our kids to not need us, but to thoroughly need Jesus. And along the way, we teach them a lot of other stuff. You know, we train them, we teach them, we lead them in every way possible. And one of the big themes that we've always led our kids in is the value of work, doing your work well, and that responsibility always precedes privilege. We've always taught our kids that. I came out of a Dutch-Norwegian home. My dad's Norwegian, my mom's Dutch. So I grew up in the Reformed tradition, both Lutheran and Christian Reformed churches. The Reformed tradition, the church reformers in the 1500s really nailed this down and said, work is part of your activity as a Christian, working well and working hard, whatever it is you do. So we tried to instill that in our kids, that idea of your life's work, your vocation, your job. And by the way, the word vocation means calling. A calling, like you're being called to something. So we raised our children, as many of you are, to know that God has 2 callings on your life, specifically 2 callings. He's calling you to 2 things. The first calling is that you would know him. That's his first calling on all human beings on the entire planet, that you would know him, how much he loves you through the Savior Jesus Christ. That's the first call. And then the second calling on your life, when you become a Christian, all of a sudden it changes everything, including the calling he's placed on your life to join him in the work he's doing on the planet in what you do as work. Whatever it is you do. It doesn't matter. You don't have to do what I do. It's whatever you do. To join him in his ongoing work on the planet. Those 2 callings. So Solomon makes clear the first calling. Using the Old Testament word fear to describe love and respect and honor, he says in chapter 1, verse 7, the fear of the Lord, the love, honor, respect of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Then a little later in chapter 3, verse 5, he says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Just give it all to him. Do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he'll make your path straight. Because if you do it, they're going to be crooked. And then over in chapter 14, verse 27, I love this. The fear, honor, respect, love for the Lord is a fountain of life. But then the second calling on our lives is to our specific occupation, our job, our work, what we do, our vocation. The first calling is to someone. The second calling is to something or some place. Always that order. All human beings have the first calling on their life. And God has gone, as you know, as you look at it, gone to great lengths for all of us, working on our behalf, his creation, that so that we would know him and love him and give our lives to him, surrender everything we have to him, actually live that, practically live that way, even in our work, which is what Solomon is addressing today. Then in the topic of work, how do we do that? So he says in chapter 24 some important words, and I'm going to start reading at verse 23 and end it, my reading, at the end of the chapter. Look at what Solomon says. These are also the sayings of the wise. Partiality in judging is not good. Whoever says to the wicked, you are in the right, will be cursed by peoples, abhorred by nations. But those who rebuke the wicked will have delight, and a good blessing will come upon them. Whoever gives an honest answer kisses the lips. Prepare your work outside, get everything ready for yourself in the field, and after that, build your house. Do not be a witness against your neighbor without cause, and do not deceive with your lips, and do not say, I will do to him as he has done to me. I'm going to pay him back, pay back the man for what he's done. I passed by the field of a sluggard, by the vineyard of a man lacking sense. And behold, it was all overgrown with thorns, and the ground was covered with nettles, and the stone wall was broken down. So I saw it, and I considered, I looked, and I received instruction. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, and poverty will come upon you like a robber, and want like an armed man. He's talking about work. How we do our work, why we do our work, in what way do we do our work. And it's actually a theme throughout the Bible. I mean, think back to the very beginning of the Bible. When do we meet God first? When he's working. We first get an understanding of God when he's creating. In the beginning, God worked, created heavens and earth. It's a theme all the way through the Bible. Then a little bit later in chapter 1, and we see in chapter 2, God made human beings, and he gave us a special privilege, that privilege of being made in his image. And for all that means for us spiritually, psychologically, emotionally, we also know it means we're made in his image to be workers. That God is not a couch potato God, he's a worker, and we, made in his image, are also to be workers. To be an image bearer of God means we're made to work. We're made to work as part of our dual-natured calling as human beings to work, to apply skill, passion, ability to productive work. What we do with our hands, how we spend our time, how we live out our days. As image bearers of God, we're created to work, to be workers. It's to be an integral part, actually, of the ongoing work that God is doing on planet Earth, his creation, in what we're doing for the common good so that others' lives would flourish and for the well-being of others, including ourselves. When Jesus comes on the scene, it's interesting. He starts his public ministry by going to the temple, taking the book of Isaiah, opening the scroll, and reading of himself his work, what he is to do, prophesied by Isaiah. And in part, he says, I have come to bring good news to the poor, to work at binding up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty, and to bring comfort to those who mourn and set the captives free. He came to work. And then, as he does his work, and particularly after his resurrection, he commissions his disciples to now go and do this. Do the same thing in what you do around the world. And by virtue of being a follower of Jesus, he commissions us as well to join him in work, in what we do to help accomplish what God is doing on earth, regardless of what it is you do. And this is the point the scripture makes about our work, to see it as an integral part of what God is doing. Well, how do we do that? Tom Nelson, in his good book, Work Matters, writes this. Because God himself is a worker, and because we are his image bearers, we were designed to reflect who God is in, through, and by our work. The work we're called to do every day is an important part of our image-bearing nature and stewardship. Then look at this. Our work, whatever it is, whether we're paid or not, is our specific human contribution to God's ongoing creation and to the common good. Now think about your job. I know what some of you do. I don't know what others of you do, but what is it you do every day? Think about your job. In relationship to your work, what you do each day, think about that in the context of thinking of it as contributing to God's ongoing work in creation for the common good. Is that true of your work? Is that true of your work? Even if you're in that season of life, and I see this at a younger age more and more, of retirement. I've seen young people starting to retire. They just set themselves up well. So in retirement, you haven't stopped working, right? That's not what retirement is, not where you cease activity. If it is, you're going to die younger. You know that. And there's no provision for that in the scriptures, that you would just stop working, stop being useful, stop contributing. Did you know the Apostle Paul in Acts chapter 27, verse 12 says, because of the harsh winter here, we're going to go to Phoenix and winter there. Did you know? It's true. It's in Acts 27:12. You should look it up. So if you're one of those people that go to Phoenix in the winter, it's biblical. But what's not biblical is that you cease activity. You still work in Phoenix unless you're there today, and then you have to just be in the air conditioning because even children are melting on the cement in Phoenix now this summer. But the reality is we are given provision for rest, for recreation. We're given provision by God himself. The seventh day God rested. Jesus went away and rested. It's not about not resting. It's about ceasing to be productive, being useful. Even if you're doing something you're not getting paid for in retirement, we all must be workers. That's the idea as Christians. In fact, I have a great illustration of this. So you know our church collects bikes. So I'm a fanatic with bicycling. I love bicycling and repairing bikes and building bikes. And when we ask you, if you have a bike hanging in your garage or bike you're not using, well, bring it to one of the campuses. And I'll pick it up and I'll donate it. I'll bring it to the bike guys at the city of North Glen. These guys that get together every Monday and Tuesday, retired guys who get together and repair these bikes, and then they give them away to kids who need them and adults who need them. And so I just took a photo of them last winter. They're in the bike garage. There's Jenny Murphy, goes to Crossroads Church. She is the director of Making Fun Things Happen for the city of North Glen, my city, the city I live in. And those old guys, that guy on the right, in the green sweater, his name is Steve. He's 92. I saw him directing traffic for the 4th of July thing as I was riding my bike to the thing. I go, Steve, you're out here again. We never stop working. That's the point, even when we're not paid for it. We're all made to work. Now, when we're working, we have a horizontal feeling about work. I know, we go in, punch the clock, do our thing, get our paycheck, fund our life, and that's how most people approach work. The scriptures now are calling you, God is calling you as a Christian to start thinking of it, not just as a horizontal activity, but also as a vertical activity, that you live like we ask people to live all the time at Crossroads Church. As a Christian, we live both horizontally out to others and up to God, even in our work. We live horizontally and vertically, simultaneously, and it's in this arch where we are most in our sweet spot, in the zone, when we recognize that not only is God watching and aware, but that he's participating and wants us participating with him in his ongoing work when we work, while we work. So the Apostle Paul makes this profoundly clear in Colossians chapter 3, starting at verse 23. You know what? Let me read the quote first because I just messed you up. Let me read the quote from Martin Luther first. Martin Luther says, and I'm quoting because he's a church reformer, "It is not God who needs our good works, but it is our neighbor who needs our good works. God is very much at work in our work and is transforming our work and transforming the world through our work." Now think about your work, whatever it is you do, paid or not. Think about what you do, how you're contributing to your job, or what you're doing with your time. And don't think of it just as a horizontal duty, but now realize that God is part of that. And here's how the Apostle Paul paints it in Colossians 3. He says this, "Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance." That's where your real paycheck is. That's where your reward is. Then I love this line, you are working for the Lord Christ. What God wants you to know, and this is the third point, that for a Christian, our work is actually part of our worship. Now, some of you need to know that because you're working just horizontally. And if you started to think about your work, even if you don't like your job, even if your job is taking everything out of you, even if maybe it's wildly successful and you love your job, it's just not about you. You are working, your work is an action of worship. If what the scriptures say is true, and we at Crossroads Church thoroughly, absolutely believe the scriptures, then what you do, whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord, because he knows it, and you're part of what he's already started. He wants you to be a part of it. And you're working, do your work as if you're doing it for Jesus. Your work matters to God. Therefore, there is no ordinary work. Some of you have work you think is mundane. Some of you have work that you're not proud of. You don't even want people to ask you what you do because you don't want to tell them. Some of you have great jobs and you're very proud of it and you love it. Whatever you do, work as though you're working for the Lord. Your work is an aspect of worship, or think of it as worship. Worship. So what is it you do? Is that a part of? So what's the worst job you can think of? You know, what's that row, Mike Rowe with the dirty jobs? What's the worst? So when I was a kid, I used to think, I don't think this anymore, but when I was a kid, I used to think, oh, man, I'd hate to be a garbage man. Because the garbage men, when I was young, 100 years ago, they would actually get out of the truck and pick up your trash can and throw it in the back of the truck. They would work that hard. And I thought, man, those guys work hard. I don't want to be a trash man. Now it's all automatic, right? The guy drives up, the arms come out, grab the thing, dump it in. And my trash man loves his job. He's a great guy. I met a guy in our church, his name is Frank, and he's ingeniously developed a system to do that job one better. He comes after the trash truck, and he's developed a system for washing out your trash cans and recycling that water so it's environmentally safe. Have you ever looked at your trash can after the trash guy's been done? If you've had clippings or dead squirrels or whatever you're killing for dinner, you are in your trash. It's a rotten mess. It's Maggotville. And he comes and he cleans it out. And I have lunch with him every once in a while. I said, Frank, why do you want to do this? He says, because people need it. It cleans our environment, and I think God wants me to do it. I think that's awesome. So, I don't know, do you clean out? Like, have you ever gone camping and used a pit toilet? Have you ever cleaned that thing out? That would be a horrible job. Or, I know you haven't cleaned it out, but have you ever thought about the person? I mean, what's the worst job? Maybe you have that job. I don't know. But it doesn't matter. There is no ordinary work. According to the scripture, all work is extraordinary. Whatever you do, even if it's mundane and boring to you, and even if you don't want to get up in the morning and go do it. June 29th, an article came out in the Harvard Business Review. It revealed something a lot of you know about your work, and I'll just quote what she said. We found that 50% of people across professions from the nonprofit sector to the medical profession are burned out. 50%. That means every other person in this room is burned out in their work. Then she wrote, this isn't just a problem for busy, overworked executives, though we know that's true for high-level workers. Our work suggests that the problem is pervasive across all professions up and down the corporate hierarchies. So I know I'm talking to people who are burned out, who need to know that God sees your work differently than you do, even if you don't like your job. Are you burned up, burned out in your job? Would you be thinking and acting differently? Would your attitude toward your work be different if you started to realize that your work is an action of worship, that God is a part of it and he has ordained it. He's called you to do what you're doing. Now, it may not be what you do for your whole life. He's not just called me. He's calling you as well. So let's let Solomon show us 3 points of wisdom for applying to our work, okay? So 3 things. Wisdom for work for those who follow Jesus. 3 things he's saying. First one is in section 23 through 26. These are the sayings of the wise. Partiality and judging is not good. Whoever says to the wicked, you are in the right, will be cursed by peoples, abhorred by nations. But those who rebuke the wicked will have delight and a good blessing will come upon them. Whoever gives an honest answer deserves a hug or gets a kiss. So what's that speaking about? It's speaking about Christians of all people should have this as a high level of morality. He's talking about morality we bring to work. So sometimes the downer in our work, the thing that darkens it, is that it's a moral vacuum. Nobody, and even in boardrooms across America, sometimes the question is, well, whose value system are we going to follow? So they develop their own. The good thing about being a Christian, we have a value system that comes from our Creator. So we know to do our work with honesty and integrity, to speak up when something's not being done right, or when there's injustice, or someone's being bullied, or there's some harassment going on, or something unethical. So I know a guy who works on heavy equipment trucks. He's a mechanic, works on, and his boss consistently encourages him, even commands, that he replace parts on vehicles that don't need replacing in order to increase the bottom line. And this guy never does it. And his boss consistently got more pressure applied to him until one day, through another guy, the boss's boss found out that this manager was doing that and fired him, and my guy got his job. He refused to do it. He said, no, even at the risk of my job, I'm not going to do this. This is kind of how Christians are directed in our lives for morality, bringing morality to bear on our work, being honest and full of integrity. Not always is a moral compass being a whistleblower, like Solomon says here. If you see a wrong, evildoer, blow the whistle on, go tell. Well, sometimes we have to do that. But more often than not, it's simply going and doing our work with ethics, a solid commitment to hard work and honesty and integrity, values Christians should bring to their work in every area. Back when Wells Fargo was expecting employees to upsell, or what did they call it? They called it additional sell. I wrote it down. Oh, cross-sell, that's what they call it. Cross-sell products, sometimes unknowingly to existing customers in order to, you know, opening accounts for people that didn't know they had accounts open in their name. It was very unethical. Back when, and we've all read this, right? We've all read this recently. It's just happened the last few weeks. When Wells Fargo was doing it, I met a lady who worked there and always refused, even at her boss's insistence, you need to start upping your sales, cross-selling, encouraging people to buy these products, and if they don't, assign some products to them anyway. They'll never know. It's okay. So when Wells Fargo was doing this, and she refused to do it, well, just about the time her boss, she told me, was going to fire her, it broke. The whole news story broke, and she kept her job. She could say, you know, as a person of faith, as a Christian woman, I refuse to participate in this, and I think God spared my job, because she still has her job at Wells Fargo. You don't have to be a Christian to have morals. That's not what I'm saying. But as Christians, certainly God's expectation for us, particularly in values vacuums, is that we work with high morality. So that's the first thing that Solomon is saying. The second thing he's saying is in verse 27 through 29. This is really interesting. It's a whole other kind of thought, but in relationship to work. Prepare your work outside. Get everything ready for yourself in the field, and after that, build your house. Do not be a witness against your neighbor without cause, and do not deceive with your lips. Do not say, I'm going to do to him as he has done to me, and I'll pay that man back for what he has done. So what he's talking about here is a level of priority in your life and the levels of priority you place on things and people. He's talking about priority. Now, I don't know if you noticed, verse 29 is almost the opposite of the golden rule. So verse 29 says, do not say, I will do to him as he has done to me. I'm going to pay him back. That's the opposite, is it not, of what Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 7. When Jesus said, we call it the golden rule, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. That means treat others like you want to be treated. So Solomon said, don't say, I'm going to get even. No, treat others as you want to be treated. So what is he saying? Jesus and Solomon are saying the same thing. They're saying there's a higher priority in our lives as Christians. And that priority is what God says, what God thinks, who Jesus is. Solomon says, plant your fields and then build your house, then build your barn. Have a priority of how you live your life, how you do your work. He's saying, know your priorities. There is a priority in our lives that flows from and stems from our relationship to Jesus Christ. Our first calling to know him, to love him. And that calling sets everything else in a priority. We as believers in Jesus, it isn't our accumulation or our accomplishments or our achievements that gives us identity. It's now who we are in Christ that gives us a new identity that helps us with approaching our work and switching up our priorities, making them, because our priority in life is Jesus first, always Jesus. And that keeps us from, especially when many of us excel in our jobs and we get a little, you know, proud of our job and we're happy with what we do and they come. Our priority being Jesus keeps us from overactive egos, for inflated self-images, from what maybe you could think of as the Ron Burgundy syndrome. Any of you remember Ron Burgundy from Anchorman when he gets on there and he goes, I'm Ron Burgundy and I'm kind of a big deal. Jesus keeps us from that. He keeps us grounded, our feet on the ground. The Apostle Paul says, whatever you do, do it like you're doing it for Jesus. Worship. It's worshiping him as you work. It's Jesus you're doing your work for. That's the priority. It's such a great perspective. You have that perspective, it changes things. So priority changes your perspective. There's a family in our church, very wealthy family, and they live in a very modest home. And I asked them one day, why do you live in such a modest home? She makes a lot of money. And I know she does. And she says, well, and they've been at Crossroads for a few years. And she says, well, we live in this home. We can live wherever we want, almost. And we live in this home because of what we've heard you say and what we've known a long time in our lives as Christians, that Christians should never live at the level of which they're capable, financially capable. Christians should always live well below the level they're capable of living financially. Why? She said, because when we live here, when we're able to live here, we have cushion. We're not all mortgaged up. We're not upgrading our lives every chance we get in order to keep that ceiling small. Our ceiling is high. It's way up there. So we have all this margin. So when God comes and he says, I want you to do this for your family or for these other people, or I want you to contribute to this, or I want you to go do this, we have margin to do that. She said, we've always lived that way, and God just blesses that. She said, I said to her, it sounds like your priorities are different than they would be otherwise if you didn't know Jesus. She said, absolutely, that makes all the difference in the world. So it makes a difference what your priority is in your life. Solomon is pointing us here to our priorities. Wisdom is knowing them, what's really important, and then bringing them to bear on the work you do. Okay. Thirdly, wisdom for work of followers of Jesus at verse 30. I pass by the field of a sluggard, by the vineyard of a man lacking sense. And behold, it was all overgrown with thorns, and the ground was covered with nettles, and the stone wall was even broken down. So I saw it, and I considered it. I looked, and I received instruction. I learned a lesson. And it was this: a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, and poverty will come upon you like a robber, and want like an armed man. When our morality and our priority are focused, our priorities are focused on and defined by our relationship to Jesus Christ and what we do with our work, what we sing about all the time, priority number one, Jesus. Well, how does it apply to your work? No matter what work you do, whatever job you do, should result in and will result in tenacity. Tenacity, what do I mean? Look, if you think your job is a bore, a dead end, you're just working for the weekend, trying to endure your job, maybe even hating it, you'll quickly start to believe that your work doesn't matter. You'll start to believe that, even as a Christian. And you'll become, as a result of that, lazy, you'll look for shortcuts, and wait for ways not to do your work. That's just what happens. Some of you know that by experience. Solomon says, your vineyard will be overtaken by weeds and thistles. Your stone wall will be crumbled, and napping will become more valuable to you than working. When the fact is, unless you do your work, unless the work you do is blatantly immoral, and if it is, get a different job. But the fact is, the reality is, all work is meaningful and has dignity, and it is therefore worth doing well, giving your whole effort to it. As Christians, when we begin to take and apply the wisdom of the scriptures and see that it has value in how we do our work and the ongoing work of God on earth, that what you do is part of what he's trying to get done on earth, you get a tenacity to it, a stick-to-itiveness, a grit about your work. Somehow our work, whatever we do for work, is God's hands. We start to see this, God's hands and fingers in sustaining and caring for his world. Therefore, one of the most fundamental ways you can honor God in your work is simply to do it well, tenaciously well. That's how you worship God in your work, being tenacious about doing it well, not letting the weeds grow, the trash pile up, because your work, you have some tenacity to it. You're sticking to it. You're even doing the job. Has anyone ever met Mr. or Miss, it's not my job? You met that person? Or Mr. or Miss, oh, I'm not on the clock anymore. That person, oh my goodness, those people drive me nuts. Really? So you have to get paid to pick up the trash on your way to your car, or take the trash out, or lock the door, or turn off the lights, or file the papers, or whatever. Yeah, maybe you should get paid for it, but I'm just asking you to do this. I know it's not your job, but those people, that it's not my job. So I learned a lesson a few years ago. His name is Brad, and he's at our North Glen campus. It's not Pastor Brad, although Pastor Brad may do something like this. I walked into the bathroom, the men's bathroom. Of course, the men's bathroom. I didn't need to qualify that, did I? I walked into the, in case you were wondering, I walked into the men's bathroom and in between services, and I caught Brad cleaning the urinal. He was cleaning the urinal out. And he didn't know I was behind him, and I go, what are you doing? And he turns around and he says this line. He's kind of deflecting what he's doing. He says, did you know the right urinal is used more than the left urinal? That's what he said. He was kind of deflecting me, catching him cleaning it. And I go, oh, good to know. I bet that left one's lonely. I just said that. So he kind of was embarrassed. I go, Brad, are you cleaning? Do you do this regularly? And he says, well, it needs to be done. And I go, are you cleaning the sinks too? Because I notice every time I come in, I mean, it's a busy campus, so there's a lot of people that use it. And he goes, yeah, I clean them between services. When I go, you know, it's not your job. We have people to do this. And he goes, it is my job. It is my job. And I go, well, why are you doing it? Why are you doing this? And you know what he said? Two words. Why not? Why not? I just love that. He's not Mr. It's not my job. This attitude Christians can bring to whatever we do. Tenacity, above and beyond, heartily like unto Jesus. Okay, one more thing, and then I'll be done. And this is maybe all you needed. I don't know. Everything I just said, maybe you didn't need. Maybe this is what you needed. So I'm going to go to a different verse. Solomon wrote it, Proverbs 16, verse 3, when he says this, commit your work to the Lord, and your plans will be established. Proverbs 16, 3. Now, maybe that's the wisest thing you've heard this whole sermon. Solomon's saying to you, commit your work to the Lord, and your plans will be established. Because maybe that's exactly what you need to do. You're at a place where you're spinning your wheels, you're not sure you like your job, you're desperately wanting to get out of it, or you're in a place where you're just frustrated in one way or another, or you like your job, but you're just doing it to do it. So what if you were to, right now, make a decision, God, I'm going to commit my job to you. Whatever I do, I'm going to commit my work to you. How would that change your perspective? Commit your work. Maybe that's what you need to hear. Just commit your work to the Lord. Do that. Solomon challenges us with our work morally, as a priority, get our priorities right, and with tenacity. Our work matters. He knows that. We know that. God made that. That's God's calling on our lives as his children. Let's be wise about it. Do our work well as Christians, as if we're doing it for Jesus. Because we are. All right? Let's pray. Father God, we are people that have been given, most of us, the ability and skill to work. Some are looking for work. Some need work. Some are unable to productively work, at least that's what they think, but they are working in their praying and they're contributing in their conversation and their love for others. So we all have that aspect of being useful and of working, some in jobs we get paid for, some with work we do volunteer-wise. Whatever we do, Father, it's my prayer that we would understand what your view of our work is and how as we do it like we're doing it for Jesus is actually worshiping you. So encourage us with that and help us to go out with that encouragement as people who are joining you every day in our actions of worship, in our work, in the work you already started and are continuing to do in this world, on your planet, for our good, for the good of others, and always, yes, amen, for your glory. And I pray this in the strong name of Jesus our Savior. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Well, that's a good word. I hope that as you go to work tomorrow, I hope you do go to work tomorrow. Hope you have a job to go to work tomorrow, or whatever you do, if you raise children, or if you are retired, or if you're working in the marketplace, or whatever it is you do, it's all worship to God. What we do here is worship to God. What we do out there is worship to God. You know what else is worship to God? Greeting. Greeting at church. Ushering at church is worship to God. So we could use you on that team if you want to serve in that way and get here a few minutes early on Sunday mornings and welcome people, welcome visitors, welcome others with a smile as they come in and help out with that if you'd like to do that. Encourage you to do that and talk to Corey Ard. Hey, Corey, he's right there. See, he's the dude with the nice-looking ponytail right there. Don't let the ponytail scare you. He's a very nice guy. He's a good guy. He's a campus captain here. So would you receive this blessing this morning as you go? The Lord bless you and keep you, and the Lord make his face to shine upon you, and the Lord be gracious unto you, and the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace, shalom. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. If you'd like prayer, come on down front. We'd love to pray with you and for you. Have a great week.
Majesty, let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice. It trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me. How great is our God? And all will see. How great is our God?